Hey everyone, I'm Ben with Pessler. In this PRTG tutorial, we're going to be covering some of the basics on the SNMP Trap Receiver and Syslog Receiver sensors. Okay, so after we've logged into PRTG, we want to browse to whichever device we want to add the SNMP Trap Receiver sensor to. In this case here, we're going to use a probe device as this. So I'm going to browse to my probe device. And in this case here, it is further down here. Actually, I'm just going to search for it up here. That's the wrong probe device. Here's the correct one. And now I'm just going to add the sensor like I would any other sensor. So when I go to add sensor, you'll see that it's available in here. If I search for SNMP REC, and there's my SNMP trap receiver. So when I tell it I want to add that, it's going to prepare a few things and it's going to ask me some questions. Of course, it's going to ask me what I want to name it. I'm just going to call it SNMP Trap Receiver. Now it's going to ask me what port I want to listen on. The default port for SNMP traps, no matter what version you use, version 1, 2C, or 3, is 162. Now, of course, this is changeable. It doesn't have to be this. If the security policies within your organization dictate it needs to be a non-standard port, here's where you change it. Also, how long do you want to keep the messages? If this is going to be an extremely chatty device, if we're talking about a device that you're going to be having SNMP traps send at a very high rate, this is where you would want to set a pretty low purge time. I'm talking like 2 hours or 6 hours, because these messages are going to go on the PRTG server and they're going to go into the volume where all your PRTG data is stored. So unless that's a large volume that you don't mind possibly filling up, you want to set an appropriate limit here that, you know, relates to how many messages you feel like you're going to get. Now, you can change this on the fly. This is not a set in stone kind of thing. We can always change this afterwards. So if you start out with one, then you make a change, you need to change it to something else, you can always change it. I'm going to go with the default of 32 days. Now, when I scroll down, we get to the filtering. This is a little bit more of an advanced thing with the SNMP trap receiver, but I'm going to talk you through it here. It's actually really simple. You'll see on the first option here, I have my include filter, and we've already populated the word any. This basically means any trap we get, we're going to show. But let's say we wanted to make a trap receiver that's only looking for certain things. I only want to see certain entries from a certain IP. I only care about certain bindings, certain spec traps, things like that. Here's how I can use this filtering. So let's say I wanted to change that to be source, and then I'm going to open a bracket, and then I only care about the devices from 192.168.0.0/24. So now, anything from the 192.168.0.0/24 network, I'll include. If it's outside of that network, PRTG is going to turn it away and it will not show up in this sensor. The other nice thing is that I can use Boolean operators here. So I could do an AND, I could do an or I could come here to the front and I could go NOT. I can combine those in any way I want. So it doesn't have to be just this. I could say AND enterprise, and then I could put in any kind of an OID that I'm looking for. Let's say it's a particular device, you've got the trap MIB for it, and you've got the OID that you're looking for this one certain event that you want to get an alert on when this happens. Well, now we'll have it just bring in only those messages, and that's where you would paste in whatever OID that is and then close the bracket. In this case here, I'm just going to leave it to any so that we get any of them. Now the exclude, the warning, and the error filter, they work the exact same way as the include filter, but they do what they say. Anything I put in the exclude filter will automatically get excluded from the SNMP trap messages that show up in the sensor itself. The warning filter, any messages that come through that meet the criteria of this filter will automatically put the sensor in warning, Same thing with the error filter here. Anything that comes through, meets this criteria, automatically will put the sensor in an error state. Let's go ahead and create this. Instead of creating an extra one here, I'm going to come over here to my functional one for this device. So you can see here, this is what the SNMP trap receiver sensor will look like when it's up and running and receiving messages. The first channel I have here is the total number of messages coming in, any drops, any errors, and any warnings. Down here, you'll see it just repeats that, but in table formats, I can see the last volume, the minimum and maximum, things like that, just like for every sensor channel in PRTG. But unlike every other sensor down here, a little bit further, here's where you can see our trap messages. Now, these are the most recent ones that have come through. We've got our timestamp, we've got our source, the agent, what enterprise it's a part of, and then the actual bindings. And then if the device supports it, the gen trap, spec trap, the time ticks, and the version. Now, your mileage may vary according to the device on what kind of data it's going to send. In this case here, we're using a pretty robust SNMP trap agent, so it's sending everything. There are some devices out there that will not support gen trap or spec trap or may not support agent. They may just give you source, enterprise, and bindings. Regardless, we can work with whatever it's sending. It's just going to depend on what kind of device it is, on what kind of things it will support. So what you're looking at here is a best case scenario. Your experience may vary according to the device that you have. Regardless of all that, I'm going to click on the messages up here, and here's where I can actually get into some of the meat of what I've got here. So you'll see that what it does is it brings up all the messages, and then I've got a show filter over here. Let me scroll over so you can read that. So when I click on show filters, you'll see that now I have the option to filter on any of these columns here. Let's say I only want to see things with bindings that talk about not available. So I type that in, I hit enter, and it's going to search. And now I've got all the trap messages that have not available in the bindings. I could do the same thing with gen trap or spec trap or version. Let's say you've got multiple devices, and actually that's a really good point. In the case of the SNMP trap receiver, pretty much any receiver sensor PRTG has, if you put that receiver sensor on a PRTG probe, it will receive everything that's coming to PRTG, not just what's meant for certain devices. It will receive everything. If this was a Cisco device or a Palo Alto or something else that I had set up in PRTG that I was receiving SNMP traps for just that one device, I would see just that one device. But because I'm on a probe here, I could see SNMP traps coming from all over the place. Hence why we can source on version, we can source on the source IP, the agent, the gen trap and spec trap and things like that. One other thing too that's worth mentioning is we can filter on the date as well. So we've gone over the SNMP trap receiver sensor. Let's talk about Syslog. So I'm gonna go back to my device here. And just like I did on SNMP traps, I'm gonna add a sensor. And when I search for it, I'm just gonna search for Syslog. And there it is, Syslog receiver. And I click on that, same as before. It's gonna prepare a few things and it's gonna come up. It's a very similar process to the SNMP trap receiver sensor. So again, it's gonna, what port? 514 is the default for Syslog. Again, you can change this to whatever your heart desires. Purge messages after, the same criteria as the SNMP trap receiver. Try to make this as simple as possible. So again, depending on how chatty your device is, we may want to set this to a low threshold or a high threshold. And then down here on the filtering, once again, it's the exact same as before, only this time we're just dealing with the Syslog fields. In this case here, Syslog has some different fields that we want to go with. So we pre-populate a little bit differently because Syslog has a severity field that can denote what's going on with that message. On the include filter, we include severity 0 through 6. This pretty much grabs everything. The warning filter only does things severity 4. And then the error filter does everything severity 0 through 3. You can modify these. These are not set in stone. You don't have to go with these. If you don't want a warning or air filter, you can just clear these out. But I'm going to leave them as they are. And so now when I hit create, I'm going to jump over here, and then here's my working Syslog sensor. Just like the SNMP trap receiver, the interface is pretty much identical. I see my messages coming in, drops, errors, warnings, my table down here with my min and max, just like I get with every channel and every sensor in PRTG. And then my messages, very similar but different just in terms of how Syslog differs from SNMP trap messages. So let me just go to the messages tab. And you can see here, I've got my timestamp, my source, the message coming through, what the host name is. In this case, it's a Zywall device. The device timestamp, so I can see when the device saw that it happened and then when it got to PRTG. The severity, the tag, the facility, and then if I have it, the app name, the process ID, message ID, and the data. So Syslog being a little bit more universal has a lot of different fields, but it depends on what you're using. There are applications as well as hardware that can send out Syslog messages, just like with SNMP trap messages, but Syslog tends to be a little bit more accepted by those because of some of the more specific things towards programs that you can do with Syslog, like the application name, the process ID, and the message ID. Just like with the SNMP trap receiver sensor, I have filtering, and I can bring that up, and I can filter on any of these columns here. It's a very, very simple interface to use. It's identical for both of them. We did that intentionally to try and make this a very easy thing to add. We know the SNMP trap messages and Syslog can be a daunting process. It's one of those things that it's not something that you think about deploying in every environment, but we wanted to add it to PRTG to make it just as approachable as we make everything with network monitoring in terms of adding it to your devices and getting the information from it. One thing that is worth mentioning on both of these sensors are not meant to replace a dedicated Syslog or SNMP trap receiver server. If you're in an environment and you want to collect those messages for any kind of standards and practices or anything like that, please keep those in place. We're not trying to displace that. With PRTG utilizing these two technologies, all we're trying to do is give you that tip of the spear notification. We're giving you that information in the same window that you're viewing all of your network monitoring data. So now you don't have to have an extra window open to your Syslog server or your SNMP trap receiver server to get that information. You can have it in PRTG, and then you can have PRTG dump that in 2 hours, but you can still have your dedicated servers holding all that data for whatever stipulations you may need to hold it for. And with that, that's going to end this video here. Again, thank you so much for watching. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate. Reach out to us at support@pessler.com. And again, thanks for watching.
If you find this video helpful, feel free to like it and consider watching our other videos on our channel. If you still have questions, please contact support@pessler.com, and always feel free to comment for feedback or suggestions for other topics. Thank you.